Good morning, FOB. I'm Pastor Nathan.
And I'm Pastor Chris.
And we're sleepy. Chris is paying attention. Are you guys glad to be in church today? Come on, let's get this started. Everybody, let's stand up to our feet and let's pray. Yeah, that'd be good. Hey, well, you do that. Then I'll...
Awesome. Well, hey, if it's your first time here this morning, we are glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. We hope that you find out that it's just like family here. You might have been here 5 minutes. You might have been here 5 years. You might have been here, well, you can't be here 50 years. We're not that old yet. But you might have been here since the beginning, and we hope that it feels like family while you're here. So look around at someone. Make eye contact. Give them a big, big smile. Show them all those pretty, pretty teeth. And say, good morning. How are you? Did you get your coffee this morning? It's awesome. If it is your first time, there's a card in the seat back in front of you. If you could fill that out, and if you take it out to the family room, the granite countertop where those donuts and coffee were this morning, we have a special gift for you. As well as if you've been here for a while and you call this place home and you tithe here or you want to give an offering, we appreciate that. We've got buckets across the front that during worship at any time just come and drop your offering or your tithe in that bucket. We so greatly appreciate your faithfulness and giving. And off online, if you're online or if you want to give online, I give online. Do you give online? You give online. That's awesome. It's just so much easier, I'll be quite honest. Writing checks makes my brain hurt. So you can give online. If you're watching online, welcome. Welcome our Church Online family. We love you guys, and we miss you if you haven't been in the building for a while. If you're joining us for online because you're traveling, you're on vacation, enjoy it. Enjoy it. It's summertime. So, yeah.
How many of you guys have watched church while you're driving with your phone in the holder? You don't have to be sad about that. I've done it. Just don't look at it. You just listen with your ears. You know what I'm saying? No. My cars are too old for that. They'll go right off the side of the road. If God has met you this week, and you could look somebody in the eye, and you could say, God spoke to me. God answered a prayer. God found me, and I read his word. God spoke to me. God met me where I was. If that happened to you this week, would you shout, hallelujah? Hallelujah! Don't tell me my God's not real. Can we worship him now? Father, we're so grateful to be here today. You are awesome. We are not here for any person or any people. We're here for you. Holy Spirit, rule and reign this day. We're yours. The church is yours. The worship team, the pulpit, all of us, we're yours. Minister to our hearts today as we worship and we lift you higher, God. We're here for you. If you agree, say amen.
Amen. Come on. Hey, we're going to learn a new song today. We're going to start off with the chorus. And we're just going to learn this. So we're going to pretend it's... worship practice right now, okay? So you're on the worship team today. So it goes like this. Here we go. Let's just see. Second half like this. Show me
one thing that's too hard. Show me waters he can't part. He's the God of the breakthrough, and anything is possible.
Come on, let me hear you. Let's sing that.
Show me one thing that's too hard. Show me waters that can't part. He's the God.
Come on, now we know it. There's no weapon.
There is no weapon that is even left to mark on you. There is no army with the power to conquer truth. You've always been with us. Battle you've already won. You've already won.
Come on, every voice this morning, let's sing. Show me. Here we go.
Show.
Come on, we bring a sacrifice of praise. How many know in heaven it's going to be real easy to praise? And you know, sometimes it's a little hard to get a praise on. But you know, when it's tough, you know, there's value in that to the Lord, that sacrifice of praise. So come on, let's just continue to enter in to his presence this morning. Father, you are the God of the breakthrough, God. Lord, we say, show me one thing he can't do. And I know some things this morning, then some of us, something comes to mind and we go, I'm not sure about that, because that's tough. And so let's just take a moment right now. You know, when we sang that thing that pops up in your mind, let's just surrender to that, to him right now in this moment. Father, we surrender the difficult things that we're walking through, Father, the difficult people, the difficult situations, Lord, the diagnoses, God, the things that are tough. Lord, we lift those and we release them at your feet this morning. And we call you the God of breakthrough, the God of more than enough, the God who sees ahead and provides, the one who sees the beginning, who sees the end, the one who's made a way, the one whose son has paid the ultimate price, not just so that we can die and go to heaven, but so that we can be one with you right now and join and bring heaven to earth, God. So we pray this morning your kingdom would manifest in Jesus' name, God. We bless you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. You're the God of the breakthrough. Again, oh praise the name, and oh praise the name of the Lord our God, oh praise his name forevermore, for endless we will sing your praise, oh Lord, oh Lord our God. Oh,
shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Come on, look on his face. Thank you.
shaking. Oh, I will stand my ground. My God, you are enough, for you are with me. And Father, you're for me. And fear will never conquer me, for I belong to Jesus.
I will not break. You'll be right there. You're in there.
somebody needs to shout today to release that freedom in their heart this morning. Come on, somebody needs to shout right now.
Thank you. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, about 3 songs ago, the Lord dropped that verse in my spirit. And Kaylee just started singing, behold, the Lamb of God. He's doing a new thing. And just in, at the last song there, when we were singing about Jesus, I heard the sound of victory just start to walk into the room for a second. But I don't think we got to where we needed to be. And so I just want us to release travail here for just a couple minutes. And what that sounds like is just all of us just groaning with a tone, all of us just shouting for just a couple minutes. And band, if you can just play behind that, because I really believe that there's breakthrough in the room this morning. And I don't know what you came in here with. We've got a list of prayer requests to come for, but I know something. If he be lifted up, if he be lifted up, he will draw all men unto him. If he be lifted up, he's the only one. He's the only one that we can see breakthrough from. So come on, just from your belly, just begin to release the sound of travail this morning. Just begin to release the sound of travail this morning. We want breakthrough this morning, Jesus. We want breakthrough. We're pressing in. Come on. Oh. I needed that. And we got some prayer requests to cover this morning. We've got some family that is in need. Can we gather around them and pray and intercede on their behalf this morning? Our brother Jeff Stakely is still in the hospital. He had some surgery on one of his toes this week, and I believe he's having more surgery last night. Okay, so he's recovering. We just want to pray that that whole sickness and that infection, it's done. It's done. It's over. So, Father, we just come to you right now on behalf of our brother Jeff, and we say, in the name of Jesus, infection be gone, be done, that no more of his toe will have to be removed, that he will have a quick recovery, that this is it. This is the period on the end of this thing, that no longer will this infirmity attack him, no longer will it be an ailment to him, but he will begin to get up, he will begin to walk normally, there will be no more pain, no more frustration, no more medication needed to cope with this thing, but right now, once and for all, let it be done in the name of Jesus. We also want to lift up Bobby and Angel. Angel's father passed away this week, and we just want to gather around them. They're right here. If you guys around them, can you just lay hands on them? And we just want to pray encouragement and strength and wisdom and favor and provision for you guys. This is a tough season, but God knows what you guys need. So we just pray right now, would you cover this couple? Would you cover their family as they begin to celebrate the life of this great man? Would you begin to provide for them in every means possible, Lord? Would you provide joy for them in their time of sorrow? God, would you give them a healthy time of sorrow, Lord? Would you allow them to walk through the stages of grief, Lord, with grace? Father, we pray for financial provision. God, we pray for clear minds. God, we pray for favor with all the arrangements that need to be made. And Father, I pray that they would be surrounded by love, Lord, that they would not feel alone in this, that they would not walk alone in this, but God, that you would rest on them as they sleep, as they walk, as they get back into work. Father God, we just pray a blessing over them. Would you strengthen them? Would you hold their hearts in your hand? In the name of Jesus. We've been praying for Alora Bratcher for several weeks now. Baby Alora was born with a couple conditions, and she came out of the hospital. She's gone back in the hospital. She's been in the hospital for a week and a half. Honestly, time has been really blurred for me lately, so about a week and a half. And they're taking her tubes out today, right? So this is progress. This is good. This is good stuff. So they're taking her tubes out. But again, just like Jeff, we want to pray that this thing is done once and for all. And we want to pray a quick and speedy healing. And we want to pray for mercy and grace upon Jack and Allison as they're parenting this precious, precious little girl. So Father, we come to you right now on behalf of the Bratcher family. God, we come to you on behalf of baby Alora, Father God, and we are advocating for her. Lord, she might not be able to talk right now. She might not be able to speak and pray these things, but God, we're praying them for her. God, we are interceding and we're standing in the gap for this precious little baby girl. And Father, we just pray right now, would those legs be straightened out in the name of Jesus? No more clubbed feet in the name of Jesus. And Father, we just pray over all of her organs right now that you would bring them into fullness. God, full and complete healing, Father God, full development right now in the name of Jesus. We pray that you would pour that healing oil over her right now. And Father God, we pray for Allison and Jack, Lord. God, as parents, they did not expect this to happen, but Lord, I just pray right now, would you strengthen them? Would you strengthen their hearts, God? Would you strengthen their minds? Lord, that when one feels weak, you would make the other strong. Father God, that when they are feeling both down, Lord, that they would be comforted by your presence, Father God. Lord, we pray for a now move of your spirit. A now move of your spirit, Father God. It's not by anything that we can do, Father God. We're thankful for medication. We're thankful for doctors. But Lord, this girl needs a touch from you. So we pray, heaven come down and heal this baby girl in the name of Jesus. And one more.
what's Jeff. Okay. Tom's brother Jeff Senevi and his girlfriend were in a motorcycle accident about 2 weeks ago. Is he okay? He's okay, but the girlfriend is in a coma. What's her name? Mel? All right. Father God, we just pray for Mel right now. We say, Mel, wake up in the name of Jesus. Wake up in the name of Jesus. And Father God, we thank you that Jeff is doing well. But Father, we pray that whatever guilt or frustration or shame that he's feeling, we wash that off him right now in the name of Jesus. And we speak to Mel. We speak to your brain. Would you come alive? Would you wake up? Father, we say that if there's any bleeds, if there's any fractures, any broken bones, any messed up organs, Father God, we speak healing over them right now in the name of Jesus. You are Jehovah Rapha, our healer. Father God, you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And we are calling on you right now. In the name of Jesus, would you come and do a miracle? We want to see a miracle right here, right now, today, in this moment. Father God, can we get the call today that she is awake, that Mel is awake, and things are going to be okay? We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Show yourself strong. The last one on my list doesn't mean it's the last one we got, but last one on my list today is for my grandmother, Lee. She was experiencing some slurred words earlier this week, and she's been in the hospital. They did some scans. Nothing showing up, no results. So they released her, which is kind of awesome, but also kind of they haven't released her yet. She's still, okay, I thought she was released yesterday. Not released yet, but they don't know what's causing it. So, Father God, we just pray for wisdom in the doctors right now. Would you just highlight what is wrong, Lord, so that it can be pointed out and that we can know how to pray. But in this moment, Father, we just pray right now, would she have a sound mind? Father God, would her speech not be impaired? Lord, would her speech not be slurred? But Father God, would you give her clarity of speech in the name of Jesus? And Father God, we pray for Steve that you would give him the grace and the mercy to walk through this season, Father God. We pray that as they come back together when she's released, Father God, that your spirit would be there present. Father God, that you would help them navigate these times of life, Father God. We pray for your covering over them. Father God, we pray for your provision in the name of Jesus. And Father, I lift up every need. If you have a need this morning, can you just lift your hand to heaven? Father God, I lift up every need that is represented here and even online, Father God. I pray for those that are sick in bed, Father God, would you rise up and walk in the name of Jesus. Father God, I pray for those that are depressed and struggling mentally, Father God, we pray sound minds on them, clear minds, let the fog be lifted in Jesus' name. Father God, we pray for those that are struggling financially. Father, I pray that you would provide for them miraculously, God, whether it be a new job, whether it be an extra check, Father God, whether it be a refund, whatever it needs to be, Father God, would you provide for them in the name of Jesus, Father God, and for all other needs that are represented here, for those that are far away from God, for those that are praying for their prodigals, for those that are struggling in marriage, Father God, we pray deliverance and healing and wholeness over them in the name of Jesus. And Father God, for every saint that has been steady and faithful and plowed through, God, I pray that you would continue to strengthen them. Father God, I pray that you would gird them up with the armor of God. I pray that you would fill them with the fruit of the Spirit. We ask these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Come on, can we praise him? We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We can bring up the house lights, guys. We got some testimonies to share, some exciting things that God is doing. Yeah. Children, you are invited to class. If you are fifth grade or under, see you later. Have fun in class. Now, have fun today. Learn about Jesus. There will be a quiz later. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Can we give it up for our ushering team?
And now that I know how much you guys love them, wouldn't you love to be a part of the ushering team? Yes. We need more volunteers across the board. And we are in a ripe season to get plugged in and grow. And even if it's just showing up once a month to serve in our kids department, or if it's showing up to work behind the scenes in our tech department, if it's showing up to be involved in security and bounce those crazy people. No, I'm just kidding. We don't bounce anybody out of here. Listen, if there's a place for the crazy people, it should be the church. So they can come in and get a sound mind. Amen? Amen. All right. So kids have been not sent away. That's not the right word. Guys, for those of you that don't know, we had our third child 3 weeks ago, and need I say more? We're not sleeping much. Edith and Susan Yoder, can I get you guys to come on down? And I want you guys to testify of how good the Lord is. Do you guys think you can do that? Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
For about a month, I had been waking up in the middle of the night with AFib. So I went to the doctor, and they doubled my medication, and it got worse. I went back to the doctor. They changed my medication, and it got even worse. Last Sunday, God's presence was just so sweet last Sunday morning. Oh, you could smell his fragrance down front here, and his presence was just so powerful. And then during the prayer time, I went down hard in the spirit. I didn't lay down. I was literally thrown down by the Holy Spirit. And when I got off the floor, my heart was back in a normal rhythm. I've had no issues, and now they've taken that medication, and they have they removed me from the one that I had a bad reaction to, but they have that medication, and I'm believing God that one day soon I'm not going to need any medication in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
If two or more agree, let every word be established. Yes. Does anybody agree that she needs to be off medication? That looks like more than two or three. So if you can point your hands this direction, Father God, we just pray right now, Lord. We see that you started a good work, and it says in your word that you are faithful to complete what you've started. So we pray right now, would the medication no longer be needed? And Father God, we pray for a whole and healthy and full heart right now in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Amen. Yes. Part two coming soon.
Amen. I didn't know that they was going to ask me to tell my testimony, but mine was I had to do a colonoscopy, and I think everybody don't want to do that. Now, I don't know why they wanted me to get up here and talk about that, but I got to obey. I was telling Nathan that God obey God instead of man, but he was talking to me too. But anyway, last year I got it done, and they could not get it done right. And all year long, Satan was just basically telling me I had cancer, that I wasn't going to live, I was going to die. I mean, he was just constantly saying that to me. So then I had to get it done, but I had to start a little earlier than I did last time. So that's why I wasn't here last Sunday. But when they got it all done, the people woke me up and told me that everything was awesome, that I was like a healthy young 20-something-year-old. I don't know about looking like one. I don't know how it looked, but I tell you what, I was so relieved to hear that, and God gave me the one about the issue of the woman of blood. You remember how long she went through so much? But the thing about it is, he said, your faith has made you whole. So whatever you're going through, it's the faith that you have that will make you whole.
Come on.
You ready to pray for me now? I want my prayer too.
Point your hands. We're going to pray. I love it. So, Father God, we thank you so much that even what the enemy meant to tear Edith down and tell her she was done, you said, hold on, I'm not done with her yet. There is more to be done. So, Father God, we pray right now, would you just baptize her in your presence even more, even deeper, even more, a fresh baptism, Father God, that everywhere that she goes, she would just be oozing your presence, Lord, that she would just be a sweet-smelling fragrance wherever she goes. And Father God, we just declare this and decree this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Mr. Freddie Jones, could I have you come on down here? As Freddie's walking down here, Freddie just celebrated retirement from the school system. He's been in the school system for 34 years. 34 faithful years. Now listen, I don't know what world we're living in now where people work like 6 months and then they decide, or don't work, you know, there's that too. But what an honor. That's incredible. Is there anything that you'd like to say?
Well, it's all about the kids. If it's here at Fellowship of Believers, working with children like I've done, or at the Tabernacle when I was a younger Christian, I volunteered out there, even though I wasn't a member. I did Royal Rangers there, did it here. I'm in the school system listening to stories. Mr. Jones, we went to the fair last night. Mr. Jones, I got a new toy last night, you know, whatever it is, or listening or healing hurt hearts. Mr. Jones, he doesn't like me. But you know what? Mr. Jones loves you. It's all about the children. God has put a big love in my heart for children. And I even asked, can God use somebody who acts like a child himself some way to help children? Because you look at my house, you see Christian magazines, news magazines, but then you also see toy trains and comic books. But God, yes, he'll use anybody as long as you're willing to be used of him. And I have a feeling this is not the end. It's all about children, the children.
If I can brag on you for just a minute, it's more than just the children for you, because almost every week he would send in prayer requests for his coworkers who were going through things. And that happened because you would talk to them, because you would reach out and you weren't afraid to ask them. And then you weren't afraid to share the gospel with them and tell them, hey, I know someone who can heal that, or I know someone who can help that hurt heart. And so you have served faithfully for 34 years. I believe you have absolutely been salt and light in the school community. I know you've had some ups and downs, but my goodness, can we just honor him one more time? 34 years, that's awesome. Awesome. Should we pray for you too? All right, we're handing out free prayer today. It's awesome. So.
Father, I've known this man. Maybe I should say this man's known me since I was 5 years old. And he's been a blessing in my life and thousands of others. With every finish line, there's a starting line. With every end, there's a beginning. In this new season, we speak over Freddie Jones. We speak over him that the desires of his heart, the ones he only tells you about, Jesus, you'd give it to him. In your perfect will and perfect way. And I know one of those specifically is so to see people touched by you. This man carries burden for others in his heart constantly. Answer the prayers. Answer his intercession. Especially for the children and for this generation. We thank you, Father, for fruit in this season of his life. We bless him and we honor him today. In your name, Jesus, amen.
How many? 33 years. 33 years. Dixie, can you stand up? Can we honor you? You don't. Okay, so 43 years total. That's amazing. That's amazing. Man, we should have had cake today. Is there ever a wrong day to have cake? Every day is a good day to have cake. Yes. Douglas Heinlein, come on down. We got some exciting news from an outreach that you guys did yesterday. And I'm not going to pronounce the city because I already pronounced it wrong 4 times today. I kept saying it wrong to Pastor Chris, and he's like, no, it's the, and I'm not even going to say it because I know I'm saying it wrong, so. No. No. I'll let
Douglas. We're talking about the faraway land of Immokalee. Everybody say it. Immokalee. How many of you have been to the metropolis of Immokalee? Okay, a few of you. I don't know when's the last time you've been there. However, when we drove in a couple weeks ago as we were once again preparing, it was like driving to Escuintla on the south coast of Guatemala. And some of you say, well, in this type of outreach, you got to speak Spanish, right? You know what? I was there yesterday. Between my wife and I, we speak several languages. We didn't know the languages most of them were speaking. We've got French Creole, which we recognize, but we don't know. I heard Pocomam, some Ishil. I don't know those languages, although I recognize them. Only about 2/3 of the people actually spoke Spanish. We're talking about a place that has been filled with people from all over the world. And we went yesterday. We only got an hour and a half before we were rained out. I mean, it came down in buckets. But an hour and a half, we gave away clothes and food and prayed for people. We will be going back August 16th. And if you would like to get involved in this by giving some clothes and canned food, we'd be happy for that. But we're going to make this a regular every 2 months. People are affected in this by relationship when you come back over and over again. And it may be 90 miles away, but you know we can reach that far. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Awesome. No, the mic stand wasn't up here, and I don't know what to do with it. And I feel like I'm lost this morning. I'm so tired. so tired. I know. One more announcement. We got baptism coming up at the end of the month, June 29th. 25th. June 25th. Looks like a 9 if you squint real hard and look the other direction. We're having a beach day, and we're going to do some beach baptisms, which is going to be super awesome. So that's here in just a couple weeks. If you want to sign up to be baptized, you can do so online on our website, fobfamily.com, or in the Church Center app. If you have iOS or Android, you can go to the App Store and download Church Center. You'll do FOB Family when you're searching for your church. And then you can find everything that you need, all the events we have coming up, when we're doing small groups, events. I said that twice. So there you go. There's obviously events there. Fantastic. All right. Where are we? That's the question of the day. So cool. Let's just get started in the Word of God. Before we do that, I'll give you a little family update. I mentioned it earlier, but my wife, Marinda, and I were blessed to have our third baby, our second son, arrive about 3 weeks ago on a Monday. And there he is. Mr. Corbin Reese Wicker, and I tell you what, I think we named him right. So his middle name Reese means ardent or fiery. You can't really tell in that picture, but he's got like this reddish tint to him, and when he gets mad, he gets red. So he's fiery. He is fiery. In addition to that, we had him on a Monday, and 2 days later, I flew out with Ren, and we flew up to Columbus, Ohio for my youngest brother's wedding. So I was just absolutely lost for what was going on, where I was supposed to be. It was just all a blur. Had an awesome time. My youngest brother's now married, and so that was super awesome. And then we flew home, and I haven't slept since. No, I'm kidding. Maybe slept 5 hours. No, it's a little more than that, but it's been a lot. And so thank you for all of you guys that have sent us gift cards or have brought us food. Seriously, we thank you guys a lot because I know there was a lot of other things going on. Becky,
broke her wrist, and we had a meal train going for that. I want to say there was another meal train going maybe for the Bratchers or something. There's a lot of things. So thank you for those that helped us out. We really appreciate it. You know, three's a crowd. So now we're outnumbered, and it's just fun. So, yeah, it's been a busy few weeks, but I'm excited. Excited to be back here. It was such a blessing to be back in church last week. And Susan said, like, worship was just awesome last week, and just seeing everyone gather down front and praying for one another. Man, that's what the church is supposed to be, you know? And it doesn't just have to happen in this building, because we are the church. So everywhere that we go, we can lay hands on people, we can pray with people, we can partner with people, whether it's in a house, in a coffee shop, in the grocery store, on the beach, wherever it is, we can be the church wherever we go, and that's super awesome. I want to dive in today. We're going to be in John chapter 10. John chapter 10. So turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10. I'm trying to get better at saying if you brought your Bibles, because you should always bring your Bibles to church. But if you didn't bring your Bibles to church, we're going to have some of the scriptures up on the screen. But today's sermon that I want to talk to you about is being led by the Good Shepherd. In the world that we live in, there's a lot of opportunity to be led by a lot of different things, right? Just pull out your phone and you can see that you can be led by a lot of different things. In fact, when you get on social media, what is it called when you want to interact with someone? You follow them. You follow them. You're a friend with them. You like them. You do all these different things. And before we know it, we have, just by clicking a button, we've allowed ourselves to trail off and be influenced by someone or something or an organization based on what they believe they want to share their opinion in the world. And if we're not careful, we can find ourselves drifting and being led by something that isn't the Good Shepherd. There might be a false shepherd out there. The Bible talks a lot about false shepherds, actually. If you read in the scripture, a lot of the prophetic books in the Old Testament speak about false shepherds or fake shepherds or shepherds that have come in and scattered the sheep. And just for intensive purposes today, if we understand that Jesus is the Good Shepherd, what does that make us in the equation? The sheep. What a noble position for us to take. And to understand what Jesus is talking about in John chapter 10, we actually have to back up to John chapter 9, because John chapter 9 and 10 flow and they're together in one story. And the whole reason that Jesus brings up this whole teaching on the Good Shepherd is because of a blind man. And you have this man who was born blind, and that is a very key element. And so I want to start in John chapter 9, verse 1, and it says, "And as he passed by," speaking of Jesus, "he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?' Jesus answered, 'It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world.' Having said these things, he spit on the ground. He made mud with the saliva. Then he anointed." I love that. I'm going to go spit on some dirt, rub it in your eyes and say, "I'm anointing you." I don't think it'll have the same effect. It says, "Then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud, and he said to him, 'Go wash in the pool of Siloam,' which means sent. And so he went and washed, and he came back seeing." Super awesome, right? How could anyone be mad about this? A man who was born blind, he's never seen himself, he's never seen his parents, he's never seen the kind of food that he's eating, he doesn't even know what toes look like, and yet Jesus comes along and he heals him, and who could be mad about that? I'll tell you who's mad about it. The religious people. What? The religious people are mad about it. Why? Because Jesus healed him on the Sabbath. You can't heal someone on the Sabbath. My response to that is, show me in scripture where it says that you can't be healed on the Sabbath. Because what had happened is that over time, the religious people had started to take God's commands and they started to filter it through their own interpretations. And before you knew it, a couple hundred thousand years later, we've now ended up with where God said, "Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy," period. Now you've ended up with, these are all the things that you have to do on the Sabbath. You can't walk this many steps. You can't do this. You can't lift that. You can't.
all of a sudden, what God said this much, man has turned into this laundry list of things that cannot be accomplished. And so a part of that would have been on the Sabbath, well, you can't heal someone. Well, why would they have had that? Well, actually, it was kind of interesting because in that day, other people were performing miracles. Jesus wasn't the only one performing miracles, except for this one. We'll dive into that in a second. But there were other people, other Pharisees, other religious officials that were casting out demons. They were praying for people. They were being healed. It was absolutely amazing. And so Jesus performing miracles wouldn't have been far off from what some of the other rabbis would have been doing in that time. Yet, Jesus was the only one bold enough to heal someone on the Sabbath. Now, you're Jesus. You know all this stuff. I mean, goodness, you're sitting next to the Father while he gives Moses the command about the Sabbath. You know what the command is about the Sabbath. Jesus could have healed this man any other time, any other day. He could have waited 24 hours, came back and healed him. But no, Jesus is very intentional. He specifically heals this man on the Sabbath to expose something in the hearts of the people. Not just the religious people, but all the people around. Because what you see happen is the moment this man goes and washes in the pool of Siloam, he comes back, his neighbors start talking, and they're like, wait, is this the man who was blind? Because he sees now, this can't be the same man. And they go up to him and say, are you the same man? He says, I am he. Yeah, I'm him. I was blind, but now I see. The neighbors don't understand it. They don't get it. They're frustrated. So they take the man to the Pharisees, the religious officials, and they say, here's this man. We think he's the man who was blind. He looks exactly like him. He sounds like him. He smells like him. He looks like the man, but it can't be him because it's the Sabbath. How could he be healed on the Sabbath? The religious officials start questioning him. What in the world? Who healed you? How did you get healed? I don't know. This man, he came to me. His name's Jesus. He said, do you want to be healed? I said, yeah. He spit in the mud. He rubbed it on my eyes. He told me to go wash in Siloam. I did it. I came back. Now I can see. I don't know what to tell you. I was blind, but now I can see. I don't know what else there is to say about it. And so the religious officials are super frustrated now because now this miracle has happened, but the significance of a blind man receiving his sight is greater than we understand, or at least than I understood. Maybe you guys understand it, but just so we're all on the same page, I'm gonna rehash it. So, based on biblical scripture and prophecies of the Messiah, he was going to be one that opened blinded eyes. And as we'll see later on in the story, the blind man actually quotes back to the Pharisees, we know that this man must be from God because since the beginning of time, no one has opened blinded eyes. So now we have this conundrum where someone's been healed on the Sabbath, which is a big no-no in the religious people. But not only that, but he was healed from blindness, which no one has ever done before. This would make one stop and say, hold on, what's going on here? Not the religious people, because they have this beautiful box that you have to fit in. And if you don't fit in the box, we don't know what to do with you, so we call you the devil. And that's exactly what happens. They get so frustrated. And you see in verse 16, some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? Gotta love that logic. And there was a division among them. So now the religious people are divided. He is the devil, but how can a sinner do these great signs? Let's call the parents. So they call the parents of the blind man. And the parents of the blind man come in and they're like, why are we being summoned? And so they say, is this your son? Yeah, that's our son. Was he born blind? Yes, he was. How can he see right now? Now this is interesting. The parents know that if they answer this, they're gonna get thrown out. So they turn it back on their son. And they say, ask him, he's of age. Gotta love it. So the parents exit the scene. They come back to the blind man a second time and they say, okay, tell us for real now. How did you receive your sight? Were you really born blind? And what is going on here? So he dives in and he goes to tell him in verse 24. I'm going to read about 10 verses here, but it's really good because, so for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." We know that Jesus is a sinner. He answered, "Whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already." Can you like hear like the like, guys, what are we doing here? "I have told you already and you would not listen." "Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" I love this dude. Like he is just like one after another. And they reviled him saying, "You are his disciples, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Why? This is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born in utter sin, and would you teach us?" And they cast him out. "I don't like what you're saying, so get out." Gotta love religion. When it doesn't fit in the box, I don't know what to label it, I don't know what to call it, so get out. Well, do you want to talk more about it? No, get out. There's nothing else to talk about here. Now, I just want to point out a couple scriptures about blind eyes being opened. In Psalm 146, verse 8, it says, "The Lord opens the eyes of the blind." In Isaiah 35, 5, it says, "Then the eyes of the blind shall be open and the ears of the deaf unstopped." When Jesus was beginning his ministry, the opening passage that he chooses to read to start his ministry is based out of Isaiah 61, but I'm going to read it out of Luke 4, 18 through 19, because Jesus says this, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Right after that, Jesus announces this in his hometown of Nazareth. Right after that, people are struck in awe, but he recognizes that there's some in the room that don't like him. So he confronts them head on, and what do? They pick up stones to stone him, and they kick him out of his own town that he was raised in. They don't like what Jesus is coming to say. Now listen, if someone wants to walk on the scene and claim to be the Son of God, okay, prove it. Prove it. But instead of them saying, "Prove it," they sat there and they said, "No, you can't be the Son of God because you don't look how we thought you would. You don't do what we thought you would do. You're supposed to be this king coming in and taking over, but you're this baby that was born in Bethlehem and you grew up in Nazareth and your father's a carpenter and you're not the Son of God." Because it didn't fit their mold or what they wanted the Messiah to be. What they said, because if you, again, you go back and you look at what God proclaimed the Messiah is going to look like, but over time they have formed him into this thing that they thought he should be. And by the time they got here, it's hard to even recognize what the Messiah was supposed to be because they had all this laundry list and everyone had all these different perspectives of what he was supposed to be. Yet Jesus walks on the scene and fulfills prophecy after prophecy after prophecy of being the Messiah. Now, Jesus hears that this man is cast out, and so he goes and he finds him, and he wants to bring some encouragement to him. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "Who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." How cool would that be? Like the first hour of your life, you're being able to see, and you get to see Jesus. And he's just this, you can just tell that this blind man, he's well versed in scripture. He understands things. And so now to be able to actually get to see Jesus face to face within the first hour of being able to have vision. How amazing is that? Jesus said to him, "You have seen him and he is speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe, and worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees, those religious people near him, heard these things and said to him, are we also blind? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains. And right from there, Jesus goes into teaching about the Good Shepherd. Mind you, he's talking to what would have been considered the shepherds of Israel, the religious people. And Jesus goes in continuing saying, truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought all out on his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. I love this, because in this short little 30-second excerpt that Jesus shares, you get this whole picture of how much he truly loves us. Remember, we're the sheep. It says, the sheep know my voice. That means he's talking to us. He says he calls them by name. That means he has named every single one of us. And when he calls us by name, we can't help but respond, is that you, Lord? And there's certain times in my life when I've felt the presence of the Lord, I've felt his calling, or I've felt his unction, and it stops me dead in my tracks. And it's as if my father has this very particular whistle that to this day, if he were to whistle it in a crowd, I would instantly know. And I can't explain it, but my feet just start walking towards wherever I heard the whistle. I'm 31 years old and my father can still summon me with a whistle. It's absolutely incredible. But all four of us, myself and my three siblings, we all respond to this whistle because our father taught us to respond to his voice. So that when we were in a crowd, if we were in a store, if we were lost, if whatever was going on, if it was at the end of church and it was time to go and he didn't want to shout across the room, he could use this little whistle that would pierce over the dull roar of the crowd, and his kids would come home. Understanding the sheepfold. Now, during the day, the shepherd would take his sheep out into the pasture because they would feast on this luscious, green, amazing grass, right? And so they're feasting, but at night, the shepherd would take the sheep and he would move them to a sheepfold. And a sheepfold could have been something that was man-made, so if they were in a town, there might have been like a walled structure that was tall enough for a predator not to get in. It might have been inside like the backyard of a house complex or something like that. Or if they were out in the wilderness, it would have been in a cave. So they would have got all the sheep into this cave, and then the shepherd would have actually laid himself at the mouth of the cave so that if anything tried to come in, they had to go through the shepherd first. And so what's absolutely interesting about this is what Jesus says next. But before we get there, I do want to show you a really cool video that I saw about a couple months ago. And I was like, I remembered this video. And I was like, I have to show this because it's so cool. It's drone videography of sheep being herded. And so if you just take a look at the screen real quick, enjoy this.
Thank you.
There's the guy's website if you want to go see more. He does have like a couple more. I love that. First of all, that video slightly terrifies me because if sheep all got together and decided to stampede me, I'm out. I lose. That was amazing. But what blows my mind is for the hundreds of sheep that are there, you see at different parts, some of them are like swirling around over here and chasing each other's tails. Some of them stop off and they're eating. The mind-blowing part for me was when they're going down the roads. And some of them stop and they pause to eat. And then they ultimately, they're all moving together. Once it gets towards the end, they're all moving together. All the sheep are moving together. And they might be doing different things. Some of them are at the front. Some of them are at the back. Some of them are taking different paths, but they're all moving together and they're getting from one place to another together. And some might arrive earlier and some might arrive later, but ultimately they all get there together. Some are focused and get the task done right away. They hear the shepherd's voice and they take off. Some are like, I got time. I know there's like 99 others that got to go before me, so I'll take my time. Some of them are hungry, so they stop and they get a little snack. They're at the front of the pack and they eat, and when the back of the pack comes, they're like, okay, I'm ready to move now. Can you see the similarities in us? Am I the only one? If we're comparing the sheep to us as Christians, I can definitely find myself in some of those. There's times where I'm at the front of the pack. Yes, let's go. And there's times where I'm at the back of the pack and I'm sitting and I'm like, y'all go ahead. I'll catch up. And there's times when I start out at the front and I stop because I just need to take a break and I need to feed and I need to do this or that. And I get a little distracted, but ultimately come along. I see so many similarities in that. But what blows my mind is how good of a shepherd or shepherds that it takes to wrangle in all of those sheep. To trust those sheep that as they're walking down a road with cars and could easily wander off. I mean, a sheep could easily just wander off in a wide open field. And yet the shepherd is confident that because the sheep know his voice, that the sheep will follow. And the sheep are confident that the shepherd is leading them somewhere that is good for them. I think it's absolutely amazing. And that's why when Jesus is sitting here presenting himself as the good shepherd, it speaks so much volume to these people. Literally, they would have had shepherds in their towns around them. This would have been a very real, tangible thing. It would have been like, you know, me saying like the manager at Chick-fil-A. You know, if you've ever been to a fast food restaurant that they just don't have it going on. And you're sitting, you're the only one in the drive-thru line, and it takes you 20 minutes to get your food, and the food comes out, and you're like, this is terrible. Meanwhile, you go to Chick-fil-A where the line is like 3 miles long. They get you through in 3 minutes and your food's hot and fresh. What's the difference? There's a management difference. Okay? There's a management difference. And so Jesus is saying, if you want to understand my ways, if you want to understand what I'm doing, follow me. I'm a good shepherd. I know where to lead you. I know where to take you. And so understanding that, our responsibility in this is understanding how to hear God's voice. And so this is not an all-inclusive list, but it's four basic things that I whipped together of just ways that you can practice or know that you're hearing God's voice. Number one, make space. If I want to hear my wife speak, going to another house, going to work, sitting in my office and cutting off all lines of communication, I'm not going to hear her very well. But if I go and I sit down with her and I sit on the couch, I look her in the eyeballs and I say, what's up? How you doing? I make space for her to speak to me, or I do it with my children, or I do it with friends. You make space for someone to speak to you. Guess what? You might hear them say something. So if you want to hear God's voice, number one, make space to hear him. Set some time aside, and in part two kind of goes with it, but when you set that time aside, don't just go sit in a room by yourself and sit there and just wait for something to happen. Ask God to speak to you. Get alone and say, Lord, will you speak to me? Will you show me what you want me to do with my life? Will you tell me who I need to speak to today? Will you show me where to open your word to? What nuggets are waiting in here for me? Ask God to speak to you. Number three, read his word. If you want to know how someone speaks, you want to know what they say, you want to know their mannerisms, all the things, their metaphors, you study what they say. And when you read God's word and you understand the way he communicates, what he uses, how he speaks, all of a sudden when you start to hear him speak in your own personal life, you can say, oh yeah, that was last night's pizza. Or you can say, no, that's God. That's God. You can say, oh, I heard this really good podcast. Or you can say, no, that's the word of God. Or if you do hear a really good podcast or a really good sermon, you can say, wow, they pulled that right out of the scripture. That was a word from the Lord. Because you begin to understand how he speaks and what he's saying. And number four, about hearing God's voice, write down what he says. Because if you're anything like me, if you don't write it down 5 minutes later, good luck. It's gone. I've had to make a shortcut on my phone where I can hit record really fast and it just opens up voice memos real quick and starts recording and I can say what God is speaking to me in that moment. Because it's so crucial that when God is speaking to us, we have to write it down so we can go back and we can say, God, is this the complete picture? Is this a part of it? Is this a piece of the puzzle? You know how many times I've ever gotten the complete picture to something? Zero. So if I walk up here and I'm like, I've got the whole thing. I've got it all figured out. You know that I'm blowing hot air. Okay? Because I can tell you right now, I hope it happens today, but every time that I teach, I know it happens with you too, we come down and someone inevitably comes up and has more. But did you know this? But did you know this? This scripture ties in here. There's always going to be more. We only see just a little fragment. Why? Because we need each other. Amen. And so if God is speaking to you, first thing that we need to do is distill it and say, God, is this just for me? God, are you only speaking to me? And start there. Deal with it on your personal level. God, what are you saying? Wow, you gave me this whole thing about anger. Yeah, who's that for? Go look in the mirror. Start there. In fact, just take the word that God says and go look in the mirror and read it back and say, if it hits you and you're like, oh, you see your face change, you're like, oh, I don't know about that. That one kind of hit me right between the eyes. After you've distilled it, then go to someone else and say, man, God put this on my heart. And I feel like it's just a part of it. Would you pray with me and maybe see if God gives you another piece? Or maybe you take something, if you've ever had this happen, this is really cool. You take something to a friend or a prayer partner, and they're like, oh, God totally gave me this. And then you realize that they go together because God was speaking one puzzle piece over here and one over here. When you guys came together, it made a bigger, beautiful picture. We as sheep got to know how to hear our shepherd's voice. He goes right from this, and you would think that Jesus would say right after all this that I am the good shepherd. But he doesn't. He actually lays out, he says, this figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them, referring to all the thing about the shepherd and the sheepfold and all that stuff. So Jesus again says to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, and the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they might have life abundantly. Now, I just want to bring a little context and remind you who he's speaking to. He is sharing all of this information because of a blind man and some very upset religious people. And so he speaks directly to them about what it means to be a good shepherd. And in this moment, he is hitting the religious people square. And he is saying, you're not a good shepherd. I am a good shepherd. You have not gone through the door. You are not willing to lay your life down for the sheep. You've come in from another path, whether it was over the wall, whether you snuck in, whatever it was, you are a thief. And so the interesting thing here is we quote this scripture a lot, John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come life and give it to you to the full or have it more abundantly. When Jesus is sharing this, the thief in this scenario is actually the religious leaders that are coming and taking away from the sheep because they're putting these rules and these laws and these regulations and trying to stuff things down into a box that just doesn't work. And they're not willing to live by their own standards. They're not willing to lay their life down for the people. In fact, you have this man who's born blind, and what they're doing is criticizing him, and then they kick him out because they're upset with the truth that he's bringing forward. I think, oh, baby. Dad ears tuned in. That was for sure my son's cry. I recognize it. From here, Jesus goes on and he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. He who is a hired hand is not a good shepherd. He does not own the sheep, but he sees the wolf coming and he leaves the sheep and he flees. The wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hired hand and he cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay my life down for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also. They will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay my life down that I may take it up again. I love how Jesus clarifies this. No one takes it from me. No one takes his life from me. But I lay it down on my own accord, because I have the authority to lay it down and I have the authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Jesus makes the distinction between a true shepherd and a hired hand. The true shepherd will lay his life down for the sheep because it's not about the shepherd. It's about the sheep. Because of this, the true shepherd will do all that he can to bring his sheep together in one place, even in their differences, even in their difference of speed, their difference of understanding, their difference of diet, whatever it is. The true shepherd will bring all the sheep together because all the sheep know his voice. The false shepherd, the thief, the hired hands, they will always save themselves first. If it comes down to saving the sheep, they're out. If it comes down to dealing with a sheep problem, they're out. If a better opportunity comes along, they're out. We see in verse 18, Jesus refers to his upcoming death on the cross, clarifying now that no matter what you see, no matter what it looks like, no matter what it sounds like or feels like to you, know that I am choosing to lay my life down for the sheep. And know that when I have the authority to lay my life down, I also have the authority to pick my life back up. He's giving them that foreshadowing of what's to come. So then Jesus brings all this, and wouldn't you know, the religious people and the people gathered around are confused yet again. It says there was a great division among the Jews because of these words. Many of them said he has a demon or he's insane. Why listen to him? Others said, these are not the words of one who is oppressed by a demon. Can a demon open up the eyes of the blind? I love it. They just come back to the simplicity of truth. Would a demon really do this? Would a demon really open up blinded eyes on someone? Would a demon really do that? After all this, there's still confusion, and it all revolves around the healing of this blind man, of all things. Listen, the world is so noisy right now. I mean, it's incredibly noisy. And just when I think it can't be more noisy, it gets more noisy. It's like everyone has a megaphone and is shouting everywhere you go because of the events of having a baby and then flying up to Columbus and having a wedding and just being so delusional and off and not knowing where I was. I really wasn't following any news or social media or anything like that.
And so when I got home from Columbus, I started hearing these conversations with people. They're like, oh, there was this shooting and this shooting and this. I was like, what? There are all these shootings. And now there's all this stuff, and you've got politics being played left and right on every single issue, and it's so incredibly noisy. And I didn't realize how noisy it was until I stepped away. And then when you take a peek back, you're kind of like, whoa, that's a mess. A mess and a half. And if we're not careful, the hired hands, the thieves, the false shepherds can come in and they can steer us and guide us and say, no, come over here. Come over here. Focus on this. No, no, eat this grass. No, no, no. Come over here. Come over here. Come here. Stay here. Stay here. This is safe. Come on, wander out into this field. Don't worry. There's no wolves. There's no sheep or there's no lions out here that can get you. And if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves drifting away from what a good shepherd and a true shepherd really is. And all the people that we follow on social media, I wonder how many of them were truly in it for themselves or in it for others. And they can be right here in the church. You can have someone get up and you could have someone, maybe not in this church. We're all pretty decent people. It could happen. It could happen. I don't know. It could happen to any of us, you know. And be prideful to stand up here and say that it wouldn't happen to any of us, right? But you have people that are in churches. You have people that are getting up. And some of the stuff that I guess I watch church culture more than maybe other people would. But some of the things that I hear pastors saying, some of the things that I see them promoting this month because it's Pride Month, wanting to be accepting of so many things and laying down scriptures and not even talking about stuff. Not even talking about the truth because we just want to welcome everyone in. If a hospital takes everyone in, but isn't willing to tell the person, hey, if you don't take this medicine, you're going to get an infection. But they say, hey, just come into the hospital. We got a bed for you. Come chill. Being in the hospital isn't going to fix you.
Right. Amen.
Being in church isn't going to fix you.
Amen.
When you open yourself up to the only prescription that matters, the only words that actually matter, this is what is going to bring healing to you. This is what's going to bring renewal to your mind. This is what's going to wash away anxiety. This is a firm foundation that you can stand on and grow in.
Amen.
I'm so sorry, buddy. He was saying amen, guys. He was saying amen. We have to be able to discern what God is saying and what God is speaking. In closing, if we can all stand, I want to read Psalm 23 together. And one note on Psalm 23 when we get there, it says, He prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. One interesting fact about that is a shepherd in the right season would have gone to a place of land called a table. It would have been a flat piece of land, a field. And the shepherd would have gone ahead of season and he would have planted seed so that when the time came, he would bring his sheep to that table, knowing good and well that there was food for them to eat. And so, well, yes, it does allude to the fact that God prepares a table for us and we can feast in the presence of our enemies. In regards to the shepherd, what it's saying is our good shepherd, Jesus, has gone before us and he has planted a harvest that maybe we can't see yet. But if we follow his voice and we go where he is, we can know that he has prepared a table before me, even in the presence of the wolves and the lions and the bears, even in the midst of the chaos, even in the midst of the shouts, that my shepherd has prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Let's read Psalm 23 together. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Amen. Listen, when you hear God's voice, it doesn't always mean it's going to be easy. It doesn't mean the terrain's going to be well. You are going to have to go through the valley of the shadow of death at least once in life. But man, if you're following your good shepherd, you know that in the end, all things are going to work out. It might not work out how you thought it would, but that's okay. Father God, we position our hearts to follow you this morning. Not just here today in this moment, but God, ongoing. Father, I pray that every day that we wake up, we would listen for the voice of our shepherd. We would hear your call and we would respond accordingly. Father, I pray that even this week, as we set aside time and make space to hear you speak, God, would you speak loud and clear to us? We ask that you would tune out the noise and the static of the world that's so easily trying to confuse us and draw us away and allure us into false things and false hope. Lord, tune our ears to your frequency. Tune our ears to your voice. We want to hear you. We want to know you. We want to follow you everywhere that you go. And Lord, we thank you right now that you are the door, that you are the good shepherd, that you have chosen to lay your life down for us mere sheep. Father, I pray that we would live up to everything that you've called us to live up to. Would you strengthen us, encourage us? Would you anoint us? Would you bind up our wounds? Would you lead us beside those still waters? Give us rest in those green pastures. Lord, we look forward to the day that we all dwell in the house of the Lord together. So Father, I pray a blessing over my brothers and sisters here today, over their families, over their weeks, over their workplaces. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Hey, be blessed this week. If you guys need prayer, come on down to the altar. There's a few of us that would love to pray with you this morning. If you need encouragement, if you need a hug, look at someone and just say, I need a hug. They'll give you a hug. God bless you guys. Have a good week.